Hey, welcome back. Let's
go ahead and get started with session 18 as we wind down towards the end of the class and think about what we're going to be talking about today. Today I'd like to spend the first part of the class actually talking about your final project ideas and sharing a little bit about what different people are working on and how some of the approaches are similar or kind of parallel to each other. And actually even encourage some of you who are working on sort of very similar ideas to work together in terms of coming up with some notes to do some interesting things that can help you with some of the evaluation you're trying to do. So first part is going to be all about kind of what people are doing with the final projects. A lot of folks are here, but the folks who aren't here, I have some notes about what they're working on. We'll see if you can kind of just kind of seed your thinking and kind of either affirm or point you in directions of different things that might be interesting. We're also going to talk about just an approach for how to go through and just tackle this whole project so that you don't just kind of dive right into the deep end of the pool with all the complexity and kind of get overwhelmed. There's kind of a very kind of linear approach, starting from simple to more complex, that I think is a good one to take to just kind of guide you through and make sure you don't get lost in a lot of variables, but actually you can kind of build up slowly but surely towards the desired result. We're going to then go ahead and take a look at different sort of evaluation functions we might be using to consider whatever form or object that you're trying to go through and optimize. And take a look at several different analysis packages. We'll look at daylighting analysis and energy analysis and some of the tools that we can be using beyond just kind of simple geometric calculations and think about how you can sort of build nodes that use them to do your evaluations. And finally, we'll get back into the whole notion of within the optimode, how within a genetic scheme you can start working with populations of Revit objects as opposed to just populations of points. Okay, so a lot of good stuff to kind of talk about today. Let's go ahead and start by talking about the final projects and really kind of what's the essential that you really need to kind of come up with in terms of thinking about a project. So at some level, you're going to be thinking about optimizing something, and at a high level, you want to be able to have a Revit model of some sort of problem space. Okay, so whether that is, in some cases, like a little urban environment, which has a site and has a couple different building forms that we're going to be looking at relative to each other, okay, that would be a reasonable Revit model to have. Other ones that people are working on are things like just sort of more simple rooms. And within those simple rooms, having some window surfaces, some shading surfaces, some different things that we can vary and just test, on kind of more of a building scale model as opposed to an urban scale model. Okay, so you're going to need a Revit model that you're going to be able to do some flexing on and have some parameters. You're also going to go ahead and have some input variables. And those input variables can really be all over the place. The big thing is, though, that you have to be able to use them to parametrically change something in the model. And optimally, you have two or more, because just varying a single thing isn't all that interesting. That's a pretty easy problem to solve. It's sort of more interesting when you have combinations of things and you're trading them off against each other. So a lot of different things people are thinking about, whether it's rotations of buildings, window-to-wall ratio in a building, the size of a window, the slope of a roof. There's all these different things you can start changing. Okay. There's also typically some boundary conditions. Okay, that's something that isn't going to change, something that actually limits you in some way so that you can't just sort of infinitely stretch in some direction. Okay, and then it really comes down to the whole notion of evaluation function. So what are you going to be testing? What sort of values are going to be computing to evaluate the different potential solutions? And even an interesting discussion we had yesterday as part of the office hours is, as you think about evaluation functions, how you trade them off against each other is ambiguous in itself, because everyone has different schemes about how you want to weight different sort of factors in trying to come up with a solution. So with add as a starting point, let me go ahead and just real quickly, I'll do this in Excel just because I think it'll be the easiest to do it that way. Come up with, I don't want to do that right now. That's why I shouldn't click that. Come back over here. Let me just blow this up a little bit. It's made it a little bit easier to read. And let me just, for each of you, go ahead and kind of make a list of sort of what the, we'll sort of say what the problem space is. Each of you are going to have some input variables. There may be some boundary conditions, things that limit you. Okay, but finally, there's probably some evaluators. And let's just kind of think about where some of these different ones are lying right now. So, how about Ms. Jackman? Let's go ahead and start with you, because I know we talked a little about it, and I asked if we could like pick on you for a little bit today. So, tell us about your problem space. What are you trying to do? So in terms of some of your input variables, what are some of the things you're going to flex as you're going to have these different building forms? I can picture those as masses and rivets, something like that scattered on the site. What sort of things are you talking about flexing? Are you going to change the heights? Are you going to change the orientation? What do you think you're going to change?
I'll be changing my height, the orientations, maybe even the number of buildings that will exist within the district.
Okay.
Great.
Okay, there's like three potential things, and you can sort of imagine combinations of all three of those different things. Yeah, try to keep it relatively simple, so you don't want too many, otherwise it'll just sort of get lost in the complexity. Do you have any sort of boundary conditions? Like, what sort of things will stop you from just like, expanding infinitely in any direction? So,
I'm thinking of a ratio between the open spaces, like the recreational spaces versus these buildings, so usable
Okay, I think of that as actually being one of the evaluators we're going to use to go through and just evaluate different solutions. Yeah.
So like the maximum height of those buildings.
Yeah, that would be like, so maximum height of the building is one. Do you have sort of a total building area or something like that? Or that?
Yes.
Okay. So if we have sort of a total building area we're trying to achieve, that'll give us just basically as we shift different buildings around, something to kind of bump up against. So we can look at the open space versus the buildings ratio. How about the other one about the looking out on the horizon?
Yeah, the directness to the hallway.
Okay, so it's a directness to a harbor view. But we actually talked about Anna just going one step further, because there's one whole notion of this: my building face and my apartment faces the harbor. That's kind of good. But we have this extra complexity in your example of one building might block the other building. Okay, so we're going to need to go through and have not only a vector, but try to make sure that you aren't bumping into another building. Okay, so not blocking. Excellent. Now, this actually seems perfectly, reasonable. This actually sort of seems, ambitious in terms of what's going on. So, in terms of just thinking about a scale, this is A-okay. Boy, you're really doing a lot of different things. It certainly has, it's kind of a lot of options available to it. So, I think this actually feels pretty good. Let's see. How about, we were talking about your example and kind of thinking about, actually, go ahead and spell your name. I'm very bad on your name.
Bazin,
T-H-A-Z-I-N. Thank you. You think I'd be better on names, but I'm not. Okay, so we've talked about your example a bit, so go ahead and describe it to people too. What are you thinking about?
Left on the roof for something like solar insulation, so if you want to install panels.
Okay. Got it. So let me even, actually. That's weird. I'm gonna bump up against it. I'm off the rails, literally. I happen to remember, and we had a picture over here.
Yes.
Just helped to explain to some other people. So the idea is, if you're thinking about a building like the Y2E2 building, we have those big skylights up on the roof. We have those atriums where everything terraces back, almost like an inverted pyramid. So the idea is kind of like for some different floors, you know, thinking about an opening that's on the roof, an opening that's on some floors below, and really trying to measure the illuminance that's happening down here on the ground floor level, just to make sure that we're getting it in and kind of thinking about what the optimal shape is that could allow kind of a lot of space up here on the roof for going ahead and have solar panels. I sort of thought about it. Another one we could even throw in is the amount of space you have on the intermediate floors, because that's pretty valuable to us too. Okay, so for your input variables, what are we going to change? We're going to change the shape and the size of the floor openings. Super. And what kind of evaluators are we going to use?
So the average illumination versus solar insulation on the roof.
On the floor. And illumination is always kind of funny, because you could say average, we could say peak, we could say a lot of different things. Okay, and kind of we'll say solar panel area on roof. I would throw in, you could consider floor area, but again, yeah, don't overcomplicate it. I'm gonna advocate for all of us. Figure, make one thing work. And then after we get one thing to work, we'll add in more and kind of start trading them off. Okay, super. Who else? Any other volunteers? Dominique, what were we talking about? I'm trying to remember.
Facade design.
Ah. Get to hand it in there. So kind of a facade design, and tell me what you're thinking about.
Like having panels that probably openings change.
Okay, changeable openings.
Respect to sunlight illumination and stuff like that.
Okay, based on sunlight and all that. Got it. So we're gonna change like the opening size of these different panels. What else are we gonna change? So the opening size.
Maybe even the angles
that
the panels,
so some aspect about, okay, some sort of angle of panel shade, something like that. Just something about the geometry we're gonna change. Super. Okay, and then how are we gonna go through and evaluate these? You know, as you think about sort of different variations. Okay, sunlight in space. And we can sort of measure that a couple different ways. We can measure that in terms of the insulation, or we can measure it in terms of luminance. Both are sort of valid. Okay, and what can we trade that off? Because, okay, so that sounds like I want to have as big an opening as possible. So what's the trade-off for that? Why wouldn't you want to have just a giant wall of windows? Anyone? I think other people are thinking about this too.
Heat loss.
Yeah.
Too much sun.
Oh, exactly.
Also.
Okay, we can contrast that with sort of energy, sort of heat performance. Now, you actually have, there is, I think, for all of us with the illuminations, there is sort of this boundary condition in that, you know, if it gets to be too glary, then it's not a good space, so we might want to go ahead and use that. Okay.
Also, if it's a huge window with very few structural components, it's not going to.
Ah, very good. So we could go ahead and think about, that's interesting. So another evaluator we could do is we could think about it in terms of there just being some sort of a structural integrity rating. Okay. And then kind of and make sure that that's staying within a limit. Something like
how
that.
Do that.
Well, I don't know. We have to sort of consider the best way to evaluate that.
Yeah. We might have to simulate the bars on the ends, sort of simulate them as little mini beams or something like that, and think about a wind force. And usually the wind is what gets us in trouble with the facades. When people were taking the facade class, that was really sort of the trade-off that they were looking at. They were looking at sort of energy performance, you know, kind of in terms of heat loss versus the structural integrity, which sort of also gets into the weight of the facade, which can contribute to the cost. There's all of these different things that are sort of related to all those.
Have you been able to figure out if that class is offered next quarter?
That I have not confirmed. So
okay.
I'm trying to get that for you today. Hey, Mr. Andrew, what are you thinking about?
So I had been thinking about a facade thing. I'm now thinking about a building form thing. Right now there are 13 parameters of electric barriers. I'm trying to narrow it down to see if it's possible.
Okay, so what sort of things are you thinking about? Give me two or three of them that you're trying to vary on.
So there's going to be window size on north and south. There's going to be a cantilever on this, and there's going to be angles to that cantilever.
Window size, some sort of cantilever size.
Yeah, also roof tilts.
Okay.
And then constraining a roof height and the floor area. So
okay, so we have some max roof height, and we have some like desirable floor
yeah,
area.
Yeah,
we're trying
floor
to...
area range maybe. And then trade-offs would be a rough energy cost and a rough. The energy cost would be based on daylighting plus, I guess volume and heat gain, heat loss.
Okay.
And the solar panel surface area.
Excellent. Super. Okay. How about you, Ms. Lemma? What are you thinking about?
So I was thinking about just starting off with a room and sort of playing with the amount of fenestration in the room based on the daylighting that it receives.
Mm-hmm.
I know you mentioned in class last time that we should also consider weighing it against something else.
Mm-hmm.
So I was thinking daylighting versus heat loss through the windows.
Okay. So we can go ahead and look at this in terms of some sort of a luminance level that we're sort of achieving in there. And then we also want to go through and kind of consider sort of the energy performance. And the reason I'm putting those all up here is that I think you're going to see that some of you actually want very similar evaluators, which I would encourage you to work on together. Or like, you know, like sort of see, yeah, you know, we'll talk about luminance and energy a little bit today. But yeah, at some level, there's common elements. And we can tackle this together as a studio, as opposed to thinking of it as a bunch of individuals in terms of doing studies. Okay, so we have a room. We're going to change something about the window characteristics. It could be like the size of windows. It could be the total area of the windows. Got it. Anything else you want to change? Or it's mostly just, it's sort of fluctuating the windows on the surface.
Does the type of glass make a difference? Like,
it actually,
Revit, is that something that Revit considers?
It should be something it considers. It does, at least it's supposed to be considering that. The type of glazing. I will tell you that Angad is thinking about that same sort of issue. So you might talk to him. Something about, he's thinking about window to wall ratio, things like that, type of glazing is one thing that he was considering about. Something that even we talked about, the possibility of looking at, if there's fins or if there's shelves or something like that. There's a lot of games we could play in terms of different kind of window features. But no, you're actually, just sort of window characteristics. And then super how those start to affect the energy performance. That's perfect. Okay, Ms. Claire, what are you thinking about? What's ringing your bell after you hear all these? Or is it still deciding?
Mm-hmm. But I don't know if I'll actually feasibly be able to do a structural analysis.
It's,
so I might do create something based on that.
Okay.
And then evaluate the luminance and energy level, just like everyone else.
Okay. They can go ahead. Yeah, there's a connection into robot structural. So if we have a shape and we can sort of break it into what are open lines, it'll describe where bars are going to be.
Yeah.
And go through and evaluate that, kind of like we do in ETABS. So you might go exploring in terms of what's going on there, in terms of thinking about that node versus not. But, you know, either way. Okay, so if you want to do it sort of based on energy and luminance, that's super. I'd love to have you play with structural, but I don't want to send you down like a raffle. So maybe something over here with structural. Okay. But if not, maybe something with illuminance or energy. Okay. Super. What sort of things then, in terms of what you're varying, it's kind of the panel sizing and the...
Yeah, the structure would be set.
Okay, excellent. Well, I just wanted to sort of get, you know, what different people are thinking up on the table so we can start to see where commonalities are. I think that, yeah, today I'm going to talk to you about sort of the daylighting analysis tool and how we work with that. So anyone who's kind of thinking about daylighting, you know, can sort of start to adapt. There's a node that's out there already that does some of what we want and needs a little customization, okay, to kind of make what it wants. There's also a series of different energy analysis nodes, including one that I think is about 80% of what we need and needs a little work around the edge to kind of make it right. Structural, you can play around with it. But I don't know, I think you can see there's commonality in terms of what you're doing. And I think at some level, the scopes are somewhat similar. You know, except for Andrew, you just had a little, but it's okay to have an infinitely flexible model now and just only focus on two or three issues for the purpose of this. Okay. Yeah. Okay, beautiful. That's all I wanted to get at, was just sort of like, kind of where you guys are. Okay, so hang on, just save this on my desktop. Excellent. So, as you're going through and approaching this, I think you all sort of have your variables, you think what your evaluations are, that's all good. I'm going to recommend a specific approach to this, to sort of not go ahead and just dive right in and get lost in a lot of optimo complexity or control system complexity. Start by just creating a Revit model with the parameters to be tested and flexed. And with that, just try changing them manually. You know, go through, if you've got some parameter values that we can set, just choose the object and try just flexing the parameters through the range of values that you think it might, you know, be included in your optimization. Just see if the object's gonna break somewhere within that range, because it all starts with that. You know, and if you get a whole lot of, as you start doing the more automated things, messages that say, oh, could not create something of a type or a size, it just really means that Revit's not working right in the background. Something's happening where we're bending or twisting or contorting just outside the range of what it knows how to make geometrically. Okay, then you're gonna set up your range of values to test. Okay, so to think about for each of your input variables, really what is the broadest range you wanna consider? Is it everywhere from 0 degrees to 90 degrees, or is it really 360 or 720? Just whatever it is that sort of bounds you, so consider those. Then you're gonna go through and create some evaluation functions. We're gonna talk a lot about that in just a second in terms of how we create some of those. But in terms of starting your testing and control scheme, let's think about just how to start simple and build on that. Because really, I'd say, at the beginning, what I'd love to have you do is to start simple. Don't even think about looping. Just get your basic sort of nodes together that are going to set a value and return an evaluation. Just do it with one value. Just put constants in there and see if that works. And debug that even at its highest level. If you do it this way, you don't even have to put it into a custom node. All that can be at the highest level so you can watch and see everything quite publicly. See if you can just make it work just for a single set of values. After you got that working, go ahead and think about building up and using a list map. And think about using a simple list. So again, at this point, you're just getting going. You don't need to change or vary all 100 values. See if you can get it to work for 10, 15, and 20. There are just like three values you want to plug in. Just see if you can do a little minor flexing. I'd probably try flexing individual variables on the inputs and then think about doing pairs of variables. So try input variable one. Was I able to flex that? Okay, that seemed to work. Let me try flexing input variable two. Okay, that seemed to work. Can I actually work with pairs now? And for pairs, that's where if you want to, you can go back and use, I'll put that node back out there, a little Cartesian coordinate, or Cartesian product pairs, where you sort of put those together. That was actually a really good way of just, oh, if I have three values of one input variable and three values of another input variable, I'll have nine test cases. Okay, which is, yeah, not so bad. But I want you to sort of get sort of the evaluation functions and the flexing of the object down first before you worry about a large search space, because when we start getting to a large search space, especially if we're using analysis node, it can take a long time. And if it's gonna fail, you'd rather have it fail on two or three iterations as opposed to failing on 50 iterations. Because, yeah, it's just, you wanna like build up and not waste your time waiting, watching the little watch spin or something like that. Okay. When you're finally ready to roll, then go ahead. If you can get that to work for a few cases, yeah, then try putting it in Optimo. But don't put it in there until you get those other things working. Because all Optimo does is, although it's very good about searching a very large space, is it adds a whole layer of complexity that you may not want to deal with right up front. However, once you do get your evaluator working, okay, it's really easy to plug it in. And Optimo is really great. If you have objects, you have input values, and you have evaluation functions, you just plug those right into the same overall infrastructure, and it does what it's supposed to do. Yeah, that's what it really wants, just sort of objects that can be flexed with input values, evaluators, and then it's good at what it does. Okay. So, kind of makes sense? Beautiful. Okay, then let us focus our attention, as opposed to at this high level on the approach, to think about just evaluation functions and how we can use some analysis packages to let us do sort of more interesting types of analysis. So we've looked at directness of face. Okay, that's actually kind of, you know, that mathematical. We have vectors between points and another point. We say there's a surface normal, and we try to figure out what the cross product is. So that's actually not too bad. This is all that, kind of vector cross product stuff. Or dot product, excuse me. Where's a cross product? It's dot product. Okay. A variation on that that we'll use that I think Jacqueline, you'll need is, I'll give you an example that shows you how you can do like, it's basically what's called ray bouncing. You can basically see if a ray intersects another object. Actually, we can even do that, even with what you have. If you have a line that connects from, for example, a window to an object in the distance, we can basically tell, does it intersect with another mass? Okay, and that's what, yeah. We'll use something like that to go through and figure out if anything's blocking. So if we're looking for blocking, we'll look for, basically, what we'll do is we'll intersect kind of a vector with a blocking element. And we'll sort of see, yeah, is there an intersection there? In terms of the geometries, we can definitely go ahead and evaluate, anything that's a reported property, the volume of something, the surface area, the floor area. If you have a custom object, anything that your object reports, we can get. It's just parameters you can get out of them. So either reported properties or ratios of properties, those are all sort of fair game. So the overpopular surface area to volume, or there's any sort of metric you might use to sort of base on the geometry. Okay. Material properties is actually something, I guess I put that more, it's interesting, I wouldn't put it here, I put it in the input variables. But there is a way of going through and changing material properties. We need to the energy analysis node, and I'll show you what that looks like. So I would actually move that out of the evaluations. I think that's more of the inputs. Typically, I'm gonna think about if that's still true, if there's any other case of that. But for the analysis results, you know, there's also the results of different types of analysis tools that we could be using. We looked a little bit at the solar analysis in terms of getting those insulation values, and that was kind of okay. Today we're going to look at doing some daylighting analysis. Let me pop that up just a level. We're going to look at Green Building Studio for doing some energy performance analysis. I'm not going to get to today, but there actually is something for looking at that, which goes ahead and ties into robot structural. So we can go through and compute stresses and strains and all those sorts of things. If we give it some geometry, we give it number sizes, we'll go through and do that stuff. Okay, so we have a range of different things, but in particular what I want to do today is talk about some analysis packages that I think are going to be useful to you. And the first one is daylighting analysis, and the second one is energy analysis. So let's see if we can go through and look at daylighting first. Okay, I have an example out there for you. It's 18.1, and it's really from something called the Daylighting Workflows Package, although in my version I updated it a little bit for the latest version of Dynamo because it was a little out of date. As things tend to get in Dynamo, it's sort of a very fast-changing environment. You sometimes need to sort of tweak things and bring them up to date. But let me just go ahead and start by showing you that. If you want to open up 18.1, it'll get us going. Okay, I'm going to open up Revit first. I'm going to talk about first where you get these analysis nodes, because they're all out there, although sometimes you have to do a little searching for them. And sometimes, the best way to sort of find out about how to use them involves a little bit of web searching. It's kind of, there's a good and bad in the whole world of open source stuff that's kind of hanging out there, and that, you know, it's kind of wild and woolly and a lot of good things happen, but it isn't always really incredibly well documented. So that's one of the issues we sort of run into. So let us go ahead and do this. I'm going to open up, if you can, 18.1. And in 18.1, you'll see a simple little building. Okay, and we'll open up a Dynamo script that actually works with it. Okay, so this building is, one of my all-purpose standard test cases. It's just one of those little ones that doesn't have a whole lot to it, but it's simple enough that hopefully we'll be able to predict its results. So this building is a little one-story building. Okay. It has some windows on the backside, and it has a little bit of curtain wall on the southeast corner. So some windows back there. Notice my building has the essential elements for doing daylighting analysis. It has a floor, okay, and in terms of doing daylighting analysis and working with the tools for doing daylight analysis, it's very picky about the notion of having a floor at a level. Okay, so a floor object has to be, there can't be a pad, it has to be a real floor, and it's very important that it's actually at a floor level, because it looks to sort of see if the floor really at that level. It's offset a little, it kind of messes it up. So you might have to add some extra levels. We have intermediate floors and funny spots. Here we have a floor. This one has a roof on the top, because it would, if we didn't go through and include the roof, just sort of say that sun's going to spill into it like a patio, something like that. And it also has a room. That's another one of those elements it likes to work with. I'm not sure if the Dynamo analysis node needs to work with it that way, but definitely the tool that is built into Revit for doing lighting analysis needs a room. So what you have to do is just go through and put a room in here. See if I can find the room. It's here somewhere. I see the tag. That's the floor. There it is. The big thing about the room to note is that the room goes all the way up to the roof. Okay, you always have to have rooms kind of capped by something. If they're not, then it's a little odd what's going on up top. They get confused. So we'll make sure it's going all the way up. So I got a room. It's kind of hanging around. It's looking pretty good. So I essentially have a little element, and you'll want to have something like this going too, whether it's a multi-story atrium or whether
It is an individual just room. We'll want to go through and create a little model like this. And within this, we'll go through and sort of set up different variables that you can change. So we have a bunch of windows over here. You know, we can change between different window heights and sizes. We can go through and go down. In this case, window size, the height and the width, there's a type parameter. So we have to basically choose the windows, choose the types, and then we can set those. Okay, kind of like what we did in that little design advisor. So we can go ahead and programmatically reset those. We can also go ahead and play around here if you wanted to change, for example, some length of curtain wall. Okay, that would be a little more involved in terms of doing something like that, but we could go through and set up that. We could also set up, if there was a skylight on the roof, we could set up and change its parameters too. So for example, if I'm going to go through and put a skylight component on here, let's see if I can find any. There's none loaded automatically, but I can go out and get a window. Skylights are actually located there, at least kind of big old square skylights. So that's one that, again, it's a type property. So if I went through and changed the type properties to be, you know, 8x8 or something like that, I create a big old skylight in the center. Okay. So we have a model. That's the first important part. We have to be able to find where we can actually flex the parameters, make sure we can do that. If we have all that in place, then we're ready to go through and start doing our analysis. Now, if you want to just test this to make sure that your model actually will work for daylighting analysis, it might be worthwhile just to run the daylighting analysis tool manually and see if that works, because if it doesn't work manually, it probably isn't going to work automatically. So just running that, if I say let's do lighting, will be a new analysis. When you're doing daylighting analysis, typically the outcome is people are trying to compare how their lighting is doing relative to some lead criteria. So there's two specific times of the day and two specific times of the year that you're interested in. So if you run this analysis, it'll go through and compute some daylighting values for you. It's going to say, great, which criteria do you want to use? Do we want to use lead before, which is the older set of criteria, which is a little more lenient? Or if you want to use the new improved, oh, I did that back. Lead 2009 was the more lenient. Lead 4 is a little more stringent. Just got to look at the difference in the criteria. 2009, it was anywhere from 10 to 500 foot candles at, that's the specific dates and times. If we are going to go through and look at 2014, or V4, they've changed it. Now it's 300 to 3,000 lux. It's actually a narrower threshold. Within this, we have the location. You have to set that all the time. But if you try to run this.
Where did you get that dialog?
Okay, where that's coming from is under the analysis tab, analyze tab. There's lighting.
Yeah.
And I can say new. So if you don't have that loaded on your machine, there's a specific plugin that we need to install on your machine. It's a lighting analysis plugin. It actually has a little bit of energy analysis stuff in there too. But it's also the same one that has the solar tool in it.
Okay.
So is that on your machine?
It's telling me to sign into Autodesk.
Oh, that it needs to do. Yeah, because it needs your student account. This is going to burn some credits. So you have to give it an account to sort of set it against. Although you guys have unlimited credits. So you're like, what? Like, they lure you in with all the free crack, and then like you're stuck with it later.
That sounds awful.
they want you to understand and explore the tools fully as a student. Okay, so let's go ahead and I'll say run that new analysis. Continue that. I should set the location. By default, it's just Boston. I'll say start the analysis.
and it's going to send it off to the cloud. What it does is actually it goes off to the cloud. What it does is it does a rendering. Typically, as part of a rendering, it needs to compute lighting values anyway, just so you have the right lighting values in all the surfaces. And it just goes ahead and kind of strips off all the materiality and then just computes and returns the lighting levels to you. So what this does, and it often takes several minutes for it to get done, is for all the different floor levels, it goes back and just computes sort of a plane of different values that'll be reported back as colors as well as numeric values. And sort of tell you how much luminance is hanging around in here. Okay, so it's going to just kind of cook away there for a little bit in doing its thing because it's going off to the cloud. We'll come back in just a little while to kind of see what the results look like. But that's where it starts. Okay. Now, if you want to do this programmatically as opposed to doing it automatically, what you can do is go to the add-ins and let's open up Dynamo. Let's check out 18.1 and I have a couple of different Dynamo graphs in there for you. If I go to 18.1, there's one that's called just daylighting nodes. That was just Angad and I yesterday were playing around just trying to see what kind of daylighting nodes exist within Dynamo just by default. And the daylighting ones are, there's this notion of a daylighting results and parsing that data. Okay, so what happens is we can go through and pick up some results, okay, and kind of parse that data, but then from those results we can sort of get color information, we get resolution in different directions, we get an image, we get a luminance value, there's a lot of stuff that comes out of it. So it all sort of comes out of this new cloud render node, okay? But just looking at this, you know, it's hard to figure out how to string all these things together. So here's how you often approach something like this. What we'll do is I want to actually pull down this daylighting stuff, and you know, I heard it's out there somewhere on the web, but I'm not sure where it is, so I might need to search for it. And what you can typically do is this, if you go to packages, you say you want to search for a package, you can go out there and see, is there anything out there that'll do daylighting? Okay, it'll sync with the server here in just a second. And you'll actually find there's a package out there called Daylighting Workflows, which is actually okay, but it's a little out of date. There's Rutabaga, which sounds so promising. Again? Oh.
You delete it and research it after it's synced. Yeah.
Oh, there it is. That is really weird.
Yeah.
That's the sync one, so it ignores it the first time. Okay, so here's daylighting workflows. It's great and it's starting to be sort of interesting, but it's way back over here on December 1st, 2014, and in Dynamo years, that's old. That's a long time ago. But it's worth going ahead and downloading. And if you download it, now it'll go through and install a little bit of stuff on your machine. So I would download that. Okay, but let me show you what it puts out there and makes available to you. Once you've downloaded a package, you can manage packages. And these are all the packages I've downloaded so far. Within this is a nice list of packages, but there's also this little thing over here which actually is a menu that doesn't look anything like a menu, but what it exposes to you is basically where is this thing installed and what's inside the package. And this is where it gets sort of interesting, because if you say show the root directory and then go into the extras folder, you'll typically find examples, okay? And that's a great place to start, because just downloading the package is really hard to understand what you do with it, where a lot of these example scripts go through and give you kind of just something to work with. So I'm seeing a lot of quizzical faces. Let's go ahead and view, if you open up under packages and say manage packages, are you getting a list of installed packages? Okay, so go to the daylighting workflows and over where the little three dots are, click on that, and you can say show the root directory. Then inside there, it's the extras folder where they typically put all the little examples. Okay, so what I did was I started by opening that one, the one that said daylighting workflow.dialog. Okay. However, I went through and updated it a little bit to make it more appropriate for 2016 as opposed to 2014. So that's where I got where I started from. Actually, just so you know, that's the same way I got the starting point for the solar analysis. I just went out there and grabbed that, and it's a pretty good starting point. Okay, but to actually implement this, let's go ahead and open up Daylighting Workflow, which is in the 18.1 folder. That's the one that's been sort of cleaned up a little bit. And we'll take a look at what's inside there. Actually, I'm sort of curious back over here. I wonder if it's done or not. Go back to Analyze. Yep, still working. Let's go ahead and zoom on out and show you how this node is working. There's actually a lot of pieces to this node, but I've tried to break them down into these color blocks and these color groups just sort of make it a little easier to follow in terms of what's happening. Let me give you the high-level tour of it, and then we'll dive into some specific things. But at some level, if I start back over on the left side, there's something that says, just get a list of levels from the existing project. Okay, in this case, I'm getting level 1 and level 2 from the project, which is kind of the standard ones. Okay, I'm making a list of those levels. So I'm just making a list of the different floor levels. That's because what it does is it goes through each of the different levels and sees, is there a floor there, and then operates on that floor. So we start with that. What happens next is we get all the elements at the level and remove anything that's not a floor. Okay, so it's going to get all the different elements and remove, if not floor, uses a list map. So it'll go through all the different elements and say, hey, if you're not a floor, you're not getting through. Okay, so that's going to pass out just a list of the different floors. This whole next block is all about just computing the bottom left, the bottom right, and the top left of each floor level. So it creates a bounding box around the floor. Okay, it goes through and computes the maximum point and the minimum point, and then it's going through and doing some minimum and max items to just sort of figure out really what are the outer coordinates of the whole floor. Now, there's a lot of kind of weird geometric stuff going on there. At some level, it's pretty simple, but I'm just going to trust that what it's going to figure out is the highest and the lowest points on the floor. Looks like my analysis is complete. Let me go ahead and accept that. We'll go back over here for a second. Let's say grab that lighting. Okay. Looks like I got one point. I have, what is it? 77% passing at 9 in the morning, 83% passing in the afternoon. Those are sort of percentages useful for computing how many points I get. I think if I have over, is it 90%? Or is it they're both over 80, I get more points. But we'll say okay to that. Here's what happens. When you run the analysis, pardon me for switching back over here, that would be like, well, it would be, but it'd be very, very hard to do that. That'd be every square inch, actually, sort of, is within the acceptable range. So that would be hard. So they definitely allow kind of just partial. Now, I'm not sure why I'm spinning so much right now. Let me see what else is going on here. I have my dynamo open. I have this open. Let me see. Because I can see what I want in the background there. There it is. Okay. Let's go to this level one plan. So you can sort of see here. Let's see if we can kind of make some sense out of this. There's my scale down there. basically, I'm going to try to get things within that level. Was it 500 to 5,000 lux? Something like that. So the way you would interpret this graph is the areas that are bright yellow have 6,000 lux. Okay, they're a little hot right now. The areas in blue are lower. You know, the areas in green are sort of right in the kind of sweet spot. So within this kind of analysis right now, you can see at least at this time of day, it's 3 p.m. right now. You know, it's a little warm over there, at least in terms of how it's going to be a little over-illuminated. It's kind of well-illuminated. Getting a little darker back in here, but it overall is doing pretty good. This is a nice sort of distribution. Yeah. Occasionally, you'll have things where there aren't windows on the backside, and you'll just get red back there. It'll get kind of, there's no illumination and stuff like that. So you won't pass, but at some level, we're just looking at these values. Now, these values are reported to us right now in terms of colors. Okay, and colors are kind of nice, but you might actually want to know what the true numeric values are. Okay, and if you want to see what the true numeric values are, it's actually pretty straightforward. What you got to do is, back over here, what are you complaining about over here? I want you to go back into the corner here. Dynamo, just so I can finish showing you what's going on back over here. Oh, is Excel still open? Oh, that's what's actually happening here. Excel's open, and look at it. Actually, went through and it gave me all sorts of grid values. That's interesting. I didn't ask it to do that. I'll think about why that did that in a second. Now back over to Reddit. Okay. So here's the idea. We have some analysis results. We can click on the analysis results if we want to. And in this, we can even go through and kind of control how the analysis results are displayed to us. If I just click in the plan view, I get to sort of choose kind of really how the analysis results are displayed. Right now, it's giving me that nice big color map. If I say, let's go through and do change the analysis display settings. So, let me see what it is. I'm going for the wrong thing here. This is whether it's lux or lumens. I guess here it is, analysis display style. If I click on analysis display style, I can change from the analysis results just in terms of showing me the colors. So I can show points, or I can even show points in annotations. The annotations would actually show me the values. So if I said, change it so it's showing me the annotations, and say OK. What it's going to do is actually show me a whole lot of numbers. Now, these numbers, just because of the scale of the diagram right now, are all overlapping with each other. That's a little messy. So if you want to go through and see the numbers more clearly, just make the scale larger, and the numbers by comparison will be smaller. So I'll make it 1/4 inch. Maybe even 1/2 inch. Zoom on in there. Trying to zoom and it's just fighting with me.
Too much text.
There we go. The other way I can play with this, though, you can actually sort of see the values overlapping. You'll see there's like 693, 713, 1067. That's moving from darker to a little bit lighter. If I go over the other corner, they're going to get very bright. Let me change this to another way of looking at it, just because it might be a little bit easier. Let me zoom back out again. In the analysis results, what I can do is change the style there too. so that within the style, there's the whole notion of just really what is the size of the text, and we can go through and make the size of the text a little bit smaller too. Okay, so that got to be a little more reasonable. To fight me today on the zooming. You'll see there, down in the corner, we have values around 6,000, we have 2,000. So at some level, it's computing a big grid of all these values. And now, within this grid, we can do things like, we can say, find the maximum, we can say, find the minimum, we can say, find the average, something like that. So one thing you'll do is just sort of figure out really what is it you're concerned about. You're gonna get a lot of numbers back. It's really, what do we wanna do with those numbers? Okay, so that's how it works over in the Revit side of things. Let's go back to Dynamo and kind of show you how it works over there. So, going back to the Dynamo add-in. Oh, sorry. Come back over here, I'll open that workflow. So, where we left off was we'd gone through, we grabbed all the floors. I actually made a little variation on the script just right in here, this little kind of blip that's popping up the top, where I got all the different floors. I basically looked to see if any of the list items were empty. So if there was a level where there wasn't a floor, okay? Because I only wanted to go through and pass in the ones where there truly was a floor. So we're just checking to see, you know, this is going to go through and evaluate all the different levels and give you a list of the floors on that level. And in our case, we're looking for any empty levels. If it's not empty, then it's going to go forward. If it is empty, then it's going to get stopped. Because that's what that little bump is doing. As we go through and follow this through, what it does is takes all that, it figures out the bottom left, the bottom right, and the top left corners of what wants to be considered in a individual floors analysis. Okay. And then it feeds it to this thing called the cloud daylighting by divisions, grids, boundary, a node that lets you go through and compute the daylighting. So how this works is if you can imagine just the same thing that we're doing manually, we're basically gonna give it some corners. We're going to tell it the divisions. That's really the gridding, sort of, you know, how far it is. And I'm not sure if that's 150 inches or 150. I imagine it's 150 inches. That's what I guess. Or it might be, no, XY division. Maybe it's 150 by 150, just subdividing it that way. But I'm not sure. Okay. We're going to tell it a view to use. We have to basically go through and export the data from the view and upload it to the cloud. That's what we were doing. Needs to have a little transaction start and transaction end because we don't want to upload to the cloud until we're done exporting. Okay, so the nice thing is all that stuff that we've looked at so far, you don't have to worry about because that's pretty much working. It's a node that is known to work and does what it does. The part where we say do a cloud render, that's the part where I'm actually hitting the button that says analyze now. So we're going to take that data, we're going to take a list of jobs, and we're going to say, don't bother emailing me when it's done. But we're going to basically run a job. Now, the other branch that plugs into that, just so you sort of know, is this part. This is all about just basically setting some environments, which are really just how does the sky look at different dates and times that you want to be considering. So we go through and use a sky model type. I guess Perez is one of them, or it's Perez. But there's several different sky models you can use. Okay. We are basically going through and figuring out for different times, sort of what the horizontal radiance and the normal radiation and the global horizontal, you know, is at different days and times. And these are things that if we want to go through and change, this is all just based on the sun, the sky, and pointer to where you can find that information if you go through and need to change that. But basically, you're just talking about how bright is the sky in this model. It wants to know your location, and from that it's going to compute its latitude and longitude. And finally, you're given a date. So the 9th September, May 21st at 9:15, so 9 in the morning and 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So this is currently set up to give those two different times, which are all about the kind of lead daylight analysis. There's also a time zone offset. If we run that, 8 hours is for us here. All right, I take that back. Are we plus 8 or minus 8? That's interesting. You might have put minus 8. It's funny, what they put in for Boston, they had 5. So I'm wondering, yeah, they didn't have minus 5. So I'm not sure. We'd have to experiment with that a little bit. Okay. But go ahead, you kind of create a date and time. And then what that does is finally creates a rendering environment. It plugs that in with the different geometry that you're plugging in and computes some data. At the back end of this, then, it gets some daylighting results, which include some luminance values. And finally, those luminance values get computed and converted to lumens. Okay, so whew, that's all in there. The good news is there's only a few input parameters you want to change on that. Most of that's a node that you're just going to bundle on up and use in terms of how you actually want it. Pulling things out, the luminance values are computed. I do a couple things here. I changed it around a little bit. What they use is they use a custom Python node they've written to go through and just map those luminance values to different rooms or somehow plot it out on the chart, on the actual floor plan. Yeah. I'm not using that part. All I did was I grabbed the luminance values, flattened that list, and then said, give me the average, give me the maximum, give me the minimum. Okay. But you know, out of these luminance values, you'll decide right in here, you know, what it is that you're most interested in computing. Okay, so super. If you can think of this as being bundled up in a big old node where these are the outputs, okay, you'll be able to, for any combination, kind of send something in, you know, change the time. What you're going to do is always take a Revit model, you'll update the Revit model, and then you'll run this node. Okay, and then this will pop back what the values are for that. Now, just to give you a sense of how this runs, but not to take too much time at first, what I'm going to do is just unplug some things just to sort of give you a sense of like what some of the initial values are. So this is like, oh, I think Claire, when you and I were doing debugging, I started unplugging things just so we could sort of see early on what the results are without going too far. And even here, I'm not going to upload the cloud render data or do the cloud rendering right yet, because I just want to do a real quick run and sort of see what are the floor levels, what are the sky values and things like that. So I'm going to go through and run this just in its current state, which is known to be broken at the end. It'll give you a sense of what's going on. Okay, so it's completed with warnings, but that's okay. Let's take a look at what it's doing. So in terms of the list of floor levels, you see it has level 1 and level 2. You'll see in terms of all the things, the floors that exist at each of those levels, I have two different lists. At level 1, I have a floor object. At level 2, I don't have a floor object, because I didn't. I just have a roof up there. This whole part over here about list, filter, and on the outside bring it, you'll see that on the in, there's no things that are in, okay, or empty list is over there. On the out, which is actually the ones we want to pass through, what is it? There's basically a bounding box. So I don't want to get the empty list. I just want to get the first one. So I want to make sure you're not empty. That's just going to pass through the one that isn't empty. That was a bad way of explaining that. Over here, what's going to happen is we are for each of the different floors going to get what's considered to be the bottom left, the bottom right, and the top left. And so there's a corner over here, And the top is over here. Okay. In terms of, looks like it's all in inches, if I'm guessing. At least the Y looks like it's in inches, because it's going from like 9 to 148. Okay. In terms of the simulation level, let's talk about that. When you're doing daylighting, you do need to specify how high the plane is off the floor. So this would be 3 feet off the floor, I think, or 3 inches. That might be derivative. Yes?
Why do we need to find the floor by levels, but not the floor itself?
Say again?
Because we can just like pull out the list of floors that are in the reference models rather than going to find the levels and whether they have a floor in it.
That's a good question. I'm not sure. To be honest, I'm not really sure why that is, because you think about, I know you only want to sort of, you know, get the room or the height for the next level. To be honest, I don't know. Yeah. I know the way the analysis works, it tends to do it, you know, one for every floor level. But it seems like, yeah, you could just go ahead and grab the floors. So, well, let's think about that. The floors are what's coming through. That's okay. How is it actually doing it? The Y values are coming from the difference from the top to the bottom. No, I certainly get where you're coming from. I know later on here, maybe it's just in the way that they're doing the analysis. We're not needing it for what we're doing. The way they originally constructed the nodes, the levels actually got passed on, and then it was doing a color map on each of the levels. So maybe it's just that it was going to go through, and it was going to do a color map at level one and a color map at level two. Because it's like, in the node, so I think that maybe it's not useful for what we're doing in terms of the computation, because we're doing it that way. It's really more in terms of mapping the computation values back to the floor levels where they belonged. So it's just getting them in the right order. Okay. Yeah, so I think it's really more just the mechanics of what they were trying to do to imitate the node as opposed to what we actually absolutely need. Because what happens is, even over here, when we're going to go through and run the analysis, what happens is you start by choosing the different levels you want to consider. Okay. So, you know, I think it's got to be using it somewhere just in the Python node. You're correct that in terms of if you follow the Python scripting, we don't use it anymore. So, good question. Okay, let's come back over here. So, I went through, I got those different kind of bounding boxes. In terms of the environments, you'll see I have a date and time. So, at 5 p.m. and 11 p.m., okay. That is, if we think about this, if it was, this is the time at 9 a.m. here, what time is it in London? Is it 8 p.m.? Yes, 8 hours ahead of us. Okay, so those are the times in London, or at the GMT. Okay, so at our 9 a.m., it's 5 p.m. there. At our 3 p.m., it's 11 p.m. there. So I think we do have the directionality that going, right? Okay, we send it all over here. Okay, somehow that combines the latitude and longitude with that absolute time at GMT. It goes, it gives us two different environments to consider, so those two different environments get mapped in with those floors, and what you end up getting out of that is basically just these combinations that are going to ultimately be cloud rendered. So I think on the input side, we're doing okay. So I'll reconnect some of the nodes. I'll say bottom, top. The environment, you notice the environment is being list mapped in because we're gonna take those two different environments and list map them in to consider each of the different times and dates that we wanna consider. Okay, up here, I'll reconnect that. And finally over here, we'll upload the data. Okay, so let me go ahead and run this. The idea is go ahead and check it first, sort of see if you can sort of get anything out of it. Even if it was funny, when we were doing the solar radiation things, there were all those times when we got a bunch of zeros, and the question is, can we get anything out of it? So, you know, you just have to sort of stop to see, can you? But give it a run. And we'll see what sort of values come out of it. So, oops, since it was already completed with warnings, let me see what's happening here. Does not have an implementation. Let's see what's going on. I'm uploading the data. Did I break it someplace else? Environment. That's a couple environments there. Email me there. Do cloud render. That looks fine. Where else did I break it? See if there's any other nodes that are breaking. That looks good there. Let me try that again. Nope, again says it's completed with errors. My guess is, well, I'm just going to reopen it. It probably has something to do with the fact that I currently have something going on back over in Dynamo right now, or in the real Revit model right now. Okay. But what happens is when you go through and run this, what you get out of the tail end is you get a whole bunch of daylighting values that could be at the average or not with. Okay, let me go through. I'll just reopen the other one. Okay, this is where we started. This was working a little while ago. Let's start running it again. If it doesn't run, it has something to do with Revit. If it does run, then there's something I just didn't hook up again right. Nope. So it's doing that. It's something else that's going on in Revit because it just doesn't want to do the cloud rendering right now. And it probably has something to do with the fact that I currently have an active cloud rendering or something like that. Oh, it's probably because this analysis is still open right there. Do this just to be on the safe side. Zoom on out. I'm going to go through and eliminate my analysis. I can choose the analysis, just backspace it. It's just an object. Okay, let's try running that again. Again, completed with warnings. Don't know, I've done something to my model, so I'm not going to debug it right now because there's some other stuff I want to show you. Okay, but for the most part, this node should work for you, and we'll figure out what's going on there. Maybe reopening my model will help. So the daylighting analysis, the big thing is you can use this tool, encapsulate most of the functionality that's kind of hanging around in here in a node. The big thing is what you got to do is basically change the Revit model around and then launch this. And then this will always basically just give you the values out. So if you think in terms of your control looping, for every value, you're going to first change the Revit model, transaction start and transaction end, and get it to update. Then you're going to go through and launch this node, okay. Feeding in whatever we need to feed in. Now, this doesn't actually need your element. This will just work on the current 3D view, so you don't have to change that. Oh, what else can you do? You might just have to pass something in and pass it back out. Whenever I do that init in and init out, that's always just I'm just sort of finding where the launch node without actually changing anything along the way. Okay. So let's go ahead and take it. In fact, I think that might even be a good way to do this is let's just kind of think about that. Well, it's not a node right now. You would basically put an input on this for the element or the building or something and the output the same thing. You basically want to wait for the building to be updated before you actually run this. Okay. Let us pause on this one then. and say, that's looking pretty good, but let's go ahead and think about energy instead. So energy is actually sort of very similar in some way. There's a whole energy node that's available to us. Fortin Thomas City went through and put together a very nice node that has most of what we need, but not quite everything, because it's based more on sort of doing conceptual masses and window-to-wall ratios, and you may be wanting to do it for a real model. So we can open up, it's called Energy Analysis for Dynamo, so you should download that, because that puts some specific nodes in. If I come back over here and go back into Dynamo, let me open up over here. Energy analysis. Oops, actually I'll bring it. Hold up, Dynamo, I'll open up a new one so I can show you the nodes first of the package. Here's energy analysis for Dynamo. It has some different nodes for getting or setting the energy settings. So all those things that are in the energy settings dialog we can change. We can get some analysis results. Notice in terms of what we can get from Green Building Studio, we get the carbon neutral potential, we can get the power plant sources, the energy carbon cost summary. That's the whole thing about what the projected fuel cost and the projected energy cost is going to be. Get what they consider to be the lead potential, get specific projects or runs, and we just get the whole range of analysis results. So there's a lot of things we can sort of get out of Green Building Studio, but let's just kind of like walk through and kind of show you again how it sort of works relative to the Revit side. Close you up. Come back over here. Okay, I'm gonna open up for this one just a slightly different model. It's just called under energy analysis, but it's actually the same building. Okay, I have a room, that's all there. Let's kind of think about where energy analysis fits into this if we're kind of working within Revit. So here's my building. When I want to do an energy analysis, what I do is I go to Analyze, and I say I would like to change some energy settings. So I can change, oh, it's an office, it's at Stanford, whatever I want to do. I can sort of say how I want to analyze it, by rooms or by spaces. I can say I want to use the building elements as opposed to the masses. That's if I have all these building elements that I've gone ahead and done all sorts of nice thermal work with. If I was doing it as masses, it'd just be a big old block. So, like Jacqueline, if you were going through and you were flexing big building forms, you'd probably just do it as masses if you wanted to consider the energy. Whereas Lemma, if you were thinking about a specific room and specific window characteristics, you do it by building properties or building elements. It kind of depends on what order of magnitude you're looking at. So, oh, a good one to include is include thermal properties. Otherwise, it doesn't take advantage of all the R values you put in. So, you are going to set some of these properties, and you can set these properties by yourself manually, and then they'll apply to all your Dynamo analyses. Or if you want to change any of these things, you can use the set energy settings node within Dynamo to change them. Okay, so either way. But chances are, for most of the problems you guys have been talking about, you would actually set these once and leave them set this way, and then do the analysis on the same basic set of energy settings. So we set those as a starting point. Ones that sometimes people change are, especially if you're doing mass stuff, oh, it's things like the window-to-wall ratio, which is the target percentage glazing, or the skylight length and width, or the target percentage skylights. For masses, people will sometimes do that. Okay, where it comes from is on the Analyze tab. It's under Energy Analysis. It's the first one there. It says Energy Settings. So what happens in the energy world is you sort of create all these settings. Let me go ahead and turn on that thermal properties. Say okay. Then we say that we want to go through and run an analysis. There's this part that says run the energy simulation. Again, that button we're going to click manually is what you're actually doing in Dynamo. You're basically saying, hey, go ahead and do this. So what happens is, yes, I want to create a model. And Now I'm ready to upload it. Notice when you upload it, it's going to ask you, hey, what name do you want to give the project and what name do you want to give this run? That's going to come back in the node too, because you always have to give it the name of a project and then a run that you're testing. So I'll say energy sample project is one, and I'll say like test run one. Continue that. Okay, so it's going to go off and just start simulating everything in terms of the energy performance. Yeah. Send it off to the cloud. And when it gets done, and it'll take a few minutes to get done, we can go ahead and take a look at the results that it gets back out. This is a slightly different report. Our one's still actually running right here right now. Let me find it. It's at 37% right now, so it's not quite done. But I'll show you what the results are on another building that we did. It basically comes you back, okay, here's your building. We can sort of get some information about kind of the number of people that are forecast to be in there, the floor area, the exterior wall area. You can find out about sort of what it's looked up as being the electrical costs and the fuel costs for this locale. So whatever location you put it in. It'll report an energy use intensity, so both from the electrical side and the fuel side. It'll do that by basically figuring out basically how much energy is being used. It kind of computes the cost for you too, dividing it by the square footages. It's almost done with the one we just did right there. It also starts to do some analysis of, for example, the potential for putting photovoltaic panels on here, and based upon different efficiencies, and how much power we can generate. So this kind of analysis is really useful, because at the tail end, it'll show you like net CO2, it'll show you the energy use intensity, it'll show you the projected fuel use, the projected electricity use, and the projected cost. So it's a lot of data there that might be useful, and you can kind of think about which of those you want to use as the metric that you're going to go through and pull up. So this is what happens manually in terms of going out. We want to basically automate this process. So for any number of buildings, what we want to do is going to change the building parameters, then run this analysis. Change these parameters, run this analysis. Change some more parameters, run this analysis. And every type of the way, pull off different values that we want, whether it's the EUI that we're using as a metric, or whether it's the total fuel, or if you're really interested in just doing cooling, we can go ahead and just get the cooling loads, whatever it is. Okay, so how that's going to work is as follows. Oh, there's our building. This one has an EUI of 54, not too bad. Although, that is a much milder building. We're located here at Stanford on this one, which is a very mild climate. There are a lot of reasons why you have lower energy use intensities. The big thing is just comparatively how you're doing that, as opposed to, it's hard to say absolutely what it means. We have some standards, but it's hard to compare them a little bit. Okay. In Dynamo, if you want to go through and compute some energy use intensities or something about the energy analysis, what you do is go to the add-ins. Let's open up Dynamo, and in 18.2, you actually find several different examples out there. So these are all examples that ultimately are based upon the nodes that Thornton Tomasetti put out there for us. So they put a lot of examples. Most of these examples are based on taking a conceptual mass and doing it, but we're going to show you how you can sort of adjust that. So at some level, we could go through and, oh, let me just open up 1A as a starting point just to give you a sense of really what all the nodes can do. If you're interested in just setting the energy settings, there's a node to do that. You can basically just plug in values. Okay, if you're doing all that. So you can plug in a shade depth, you can plug in the skylight percentage, you can plug in all those settings are available in the dialog. Now, these nodes that say unresolved, this is something that's a little bit strange right now in terms of why they're unresolved. I know how to get around that. But basically, what it's looking is for a string value. So when you say building type, it's looking for a dropdown. In some implementations, and it didn't include the node that lets us get that, There's, I found something that said something about it being on a code block. What that's doing is, if I go to the energy settings, the building type is this. So if you know that it's going to be an office or something like that, and you're not concerned about that, you could just go ahead and put office in like that. Okay, and that'll take care of that. So if you find any missing type dropdowns, the easiest thing to do is just replace them with strings. Okay, if it's available in the dropdown, you can get it that way. Okay, so you can set the energy settings. Let me go ahead and say no to that. Other things you can do within this are, open this up, 18. Let's go to create the energy model and set the surface parameters. This one's more based on the notion that you have a conceptual mass on. You're going to basically kind of divide it into mass levels. You're going to go through and decompose the zones or repair an energy model by doing that. Then this goes through and finds some wall surfaces and sets the wall surfaces to kind of on those specific walls, a glazing percentage, a shading depth, and sill height. So that's just making some specific parameter changes to some walls in there. Yeah, that's more for the conceptual side, so I'm not going to dwell on this, because it's really more, most of us, I think, are interested in doing it for a true building that you've already modeled, and you want to use those values instead. At the tail over in this, let's go ahead and say 5A, get the run results. After you run something, you can get the results. The way it works is after we run something, we can go ahead and sort of get a project, get a run ID, and then out of the run, because Dynamo or Green Building Studio will have a number of different runs, we can go through and pull out things like, if we want to get the carbon neutral potential, we can get the CO2 emissions, we can get the net CO2 emissions, we can, the largest HCB equivalent of what the CO2 is. We can get sort of the life cycle cost, the annual energy cost, annual CO2 emissions, any of those values. So all those values that you're used to seeing sitting over in those graphs are available here. So we get these summary sort of results, or we can also go through and get very detailed results, where, again, we're going to get some results, and then from there, get energy model results. And when we run this, you'll see we're actually going to get like the full report. So it's going to be a lot of data that's going to come back for that specific run. Again, there's something with a run result drop down, but we'll go ahead and get that result. But this node is about 80% of what we need it to be. The big change that it's missing from where we want it to be and what we really need is that it's all based on typically doing masses, and we don't want to do masses. We typically want to do real building elements. So let me show you what we found that's going to help us get to that point. Out there in the file in 18.2, there's actually a paper that was written as a tutorial from John Haymaker at Georgia Tech, talking about how we can use energy analysis using Dynamo and kind of giving a tutorial about how to do that. And for people who want to do energy analysis, this is, again, something that we just need to get together and have one of you do. But what we need to do is as follows. In this paper, he describes, basically a flow for his students to go through and do it. It starts by just setting the city, setting those properties. It's all sort of outlined in here. Opening Dynamo, downloading the packages. It's all the same in there. Okay, setting the building type dropdown. Setting up the energy analysis, giving it a title. All the different things that we typically need to do. But where we need to ultimately sort of like do something a little bit interesting is go through and right about here, We are going to go through and actually export some GBXML to go through and consider your detailed building model as opposed to just using the masses. And he's actually given us the scripting we need to type in there. We're going to find that in Dynamo we can create a script file, a Python script that'll do some custom functionality. In this case, all we're really feeding in is a file. We want to go through a path and a file name, and what's going to happen is the code that he's giving us right here. We'll go through and basically export the GBXML for the Revit model so that we can go ahead and bring in the analysis on it. So this is really the essence of it, and although this may look very clunky or scary to some people, it's all written in Python. Most of what's happening here is just sort of standard stuff about just setting up Revit to do something. The part that's actually interesting to you is just lines 29 and 30, where we say we're going to set some GBL export options, and we're going to export the document using those options. That's pretty much it. That's going to export a text file that describes it, and then we're going to be able to send that text file into Green Building Studio to do the analysis. So if that all sounds scary and a little bit outside the realm of what you feel comfortable with, not to worry, we just need to get someone to type in that code and create the node for us, and then we'll all have something that'll exploit the GBXML. What we can do then is basically run the analysis by feeding it the path, so feeding it the GBXML, okay? And then after we run that analysis, we're able to, on the tail end, just go ahead and get the analysis results and choose which of the different results we want. And you can see you can pull out, oh, if you want to get sort of the annual energy use, it's basically, it's kind of interesting here. So the list, electrical kilowatt hours, fuel therms, electrical use intensity, it's basically reporting all those different values. So we might decide that what we want to do is always pull out the energy use intensity or something like that. So we'd always get that number out, pull it out of the list, and that would be the result we would return. So long-winded way of saying at some level, it's doable. It's going to take, half an hour of someone kind of messing around with it. But if we do that, we'll actually get a node that'll let us kind of export any Revit model to get the analysis results out. And I encourage you to go ahead and share that. If you do go through and get that out, everyone who's interested in energy use intensity, we should like pass that around, sort of post that into place so people can get that. So we're adding to the open source community of nodes that are available.
Where is that document?
Okay, this is actually currently, we put it in 18.2, so in the examples there, it's hanging right there. Okay. So those are two examples of just sort of how you can start using analysis nodes. Not everything complete, but I think that you're 90% of where you need to be in terms of really having some interesting evaluator nodes. It's a matter of taking that kind of analysis and putting it in nodes where you feed it an input and you get an output. Okay, let me finish up with this one last concept for today, and then we can let dig into that, and we'll have some office hours and spend some time looking at that. We'll be around tomorrow afternoon. I'll post something about doing that too. The last thing I want to show, though, is really how you start to can use this in sort of a control structure and think about using this in Dynamo. And there's a whole example. We sort of looked at it last time briefly. It's now in 18.3. It's really about just going through and evaluating a series of different Revit elements. Okay. As like some sort of like a Dynamo script. So let's go ahead and take a look at this. This is based on the idea of creating sort of generations of Revit elements. Okay, it's a little bit different. If you have a single thing you're gonna flex, that'll be a little bit different. We'll think of some other way to create a generation for you, or you can even do it exhaustively if that's what's necessary. But let me show you how, if you're a building form person, you wanna look at that, you might approach this problem. So if I go multiple buildings, let's just start with that. The idea is what I have here is I have a whole bunch of little buildings. Each of these buildings has height, width, depth,
I'm really trying to find something about the optimal ratio of like height to width and do something so I can figure out the surface area to the volume enclosed. But what I want to do is think about trying to find that form. So one way, if you use a very dynamo-like approach, is to think about creating a population of buildings, where I take a whole generation of buildings that have uniform properties, and then I test different variations of parameters to sort of see what would happen to the next generation if I biased towards the ones that yielded better results. So the idea behind this example is we go through and we start with just a generation of buildings, and then we evaluate each member of the generation. So it's very much like evaluating all those points. We had all those x and y points, and we wanted to evaluate what the z is at each of those points. Okay, and all these buildings in this generation, I could evaluate their surface area efficiency, something like that. And how that works, let me kind of just finish by showing you this, is if I come on over here, I'll open up the dynamo. Let me say, we'll do 2B. What I am going to do is as follows. I'm going to go through and still, if I use, this is more in the optimal sense, as opposed to the kind of doing it as a list map sense, I'm going to go through and have some value that has an upper limit and has a lower limit. So in this case, I think it's height that I'm varying, but I set an upper and lower limit to that. If I have two different values in here, then I'm going to have pairs of values that I'm going to consider. But what's going to happen is it's going to pass those values on down, okay, and we have to do something with them. So what I chose to do with them, go ahead and go through box, okay, is go through and create a population of boxes. So here's my box. And what we're going to do is do as follows. We are going to go through and create a population of them based on how many. Okay, we currently said there were going to be 7 of them. So I'm going to create just basically some locations, put some points at those locations, and then put a series of different family instances at those locations. So if I said I wanted 6 points, or 6, I'm going to put 6 different buildings, each of them 50 feet apart from each other. I had 7, and it's 7 of them. But what this is going to do is create a list of elements. And that list of elements is actually what we need to operate on, because we have a list of different buildings, and now we can go ahead and try to apply our fitness function to each of those different buildings. So the way the population works is we just sort of need to spawn a population of Revit elements. After that, when we're trying to evaluate the fitness of each of those, what we do is we give it a list of elements. At some level, we take those elements, and for each of the elements, we go through and basically evaluate each and every one of them. And the evaluation is always, let's go ahead and feed it a single element. We're going to go through and get some value. We're going to kind of transaction start, set the value, transaction end, and we're going to get some parameters back that are the results. Ultimately, returning that result. But let's go ahead and kind of think about how we have to do this, because there's 2 levels of list maps, and I'll end there today in terms of what's going on. What I have to do is as follows. I don't even have my little, there they are, markers right there. Okay, at some point, what you have to do is you basically have to sort of evaluate each instance. Okay, so we need to pass in some sort of test values, and we're going to get a result over here. Okay, that is a node. But what I have to do is actually take that node and put it into another node. Okay. which is going to be evaluate all items in the generation. Okay. And that's going to have a list map. Okay, and as the input, you're going to have basically like a generation. Going to happen is that generation comes to the list map, this plugs into the list map, and what happens is there's something over here which says element, which is open. Okay, which is open, whereas all the other values are sort of plugged in. And the reason we do it that way is we need to use the list map to go through and get all five of the elements in the generation to kind of come together. So if you're looking at 18.3, what happens is there's an outer function, which is just to evaluate the entire generation. And there's an inner node, which is to evaluate each item in the generation. Okay, and if you can handle that concept, everything else sort of lays out pretty much, you know, in a straightforward fashion, because what we do for every individual element is just set the values. So that one in turn, it always follows the same basic structure. We always basically grab an element, we get the test values. We always basically go through and we say transaction start. We sort of set, and then we end. And after we've transacted and done that, we take that back and we do a get. And that becomes the output. So it's like a hierarchy of different levels. But if you can sort of understand just that overall notion of for every generation that has multiple elements, you're going to go through and break it into a list that sort of gets each of them individually, then evaluate each of them. This, for every item, will go through and return a value. So what this list map does is it returns a whole list of results, which then gets passed on up to Optimo so we can go ahead and use it as the evaluation. So I apologize if that's somewhat obtuse or confusing. We'll go ahead and talk about that some more on like a Tuesday in terms of how to use that kind of infrastructure. But how about this, between now and Tuesday? We'll have office hours tomorrow, so if you want to come in tomorrow, we'll post those. We'll pretty much, that's all I have for you. Should be in here. If you want to start by just working on your evaluation functions and just trying to get the evaluator to work for one item, okay, or two items, start there, because that's really the way to start. How we ultimately link it all together into Optimo or into bigger control scheme that's more sophisticated on this map. You know, if we get the evaluator working, that part's easy, because they all sort of basically lay out the same way. So see if you can get your Revit model working in terms of something that you can flex manually, and also go through and see if you get your evaluation function to kind of return some value so that if you tweaked it manually, you've got results back, and then we can hook together the infrastructure to drive it automatically. Okay? Any questions? It's a lot of stuff out there today. Okay, so let us adjourn for today, and we will resume.